Got a call yesterday, friend of ours had to be rushed to the hospital in intensive care, and we're going to go see him tomorrow. And the first thing that came to my mind was, well, let's say a prayer for him. And it was, let just Holy Spirit back off all the symptoms. Ease all the symptoms. Just ease all the symptoms. That's all. And this should be the prayer, I think, for all of us right now, is just ease off all the symptoms of insanity that arise from insanity, which is all sickness. It's the condition that we've been experiencing, thinking that we're experiencing for so long. Just ease off, across the board, all of those symptoms. Walk them back a little bit. Walk them back. And we just heard he's out of intensive care in a room right now. This is what smartness, the ego, doesn't want. This is what it doesn't like. It doesn't want this. It doesn't want us to get to this recognition. Now, I continue this theme of black, white with black accents. Black accent would mean we're not leaving perception altogether. See, the ego frightens us into telling us, no, it's all or nothing. You've got to leap into knowing and completely the universe must disappear, perception must disappear, and all this. Otherwise, you know, that's anything other than that's a complete failure on your part. This is absolutely not true, and it scares us. The ego knows that it scares us, so it promotes this idea that we're supposed to leap, be catapulted into knowing, to prove that we really are spirit. We don't have to prove anything to ourselves, really, other than the fact that we can't evaporate continuity fear. But we certainly don't have to do what the ego tells us to do. It's a scare tactic it uses, and then it gets our attention. And because we're afraid, we say, whoa, 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 I don't want to do that, ego. Protect me. The ego says, okay, I'll protect you. I know how to protect you. So we keep our attention, we keep listening to the ego, because the ego scares us by telling us that what trying to boss us and tell us what we have to do spiritually. Whereas the Holy Spirit says, no, you can keep perception. Just give a different purpose to perception. Just give a different purpose to belief. Just allow perception to give you a plausible inference that reality is still real, that light is still light. So we can ease off all the symptoms of insanity. Ease off and walk back the symptoms of insanity. Just ease back on the throttle, so to speak. Not so much gas. We don't have to make these miraculous, stunning recoveries. See, this is the thing. We're looking for the miraculous and overlooking the pragmatic, I would say. We don't need the real miraculous is to ease back on everything at once. That's what's truly miraculous. So don't pray for anything specific, I would say. Just ask the Holy Spirit to pull back on everything. All symptoms of insanity. Pull back on all symptoms of insanity. This is quite extraordinary breakthrough, I believe. You just don't hear this talked about. And for some reason, it only comes up when we're ready to hear it. Because the ego absolutely prohibits this. It just says, but, it's speech that has no words to describe its disdain for this, and its disdain is so complete for this that we're afraid to go here. We think, well, I don't want to face the disdain of the ego, the terrible. Well, here we go. That's what we're doing here. So I keep this white with black trim theme. And suddenly today I realized that the dream I had of this terrible storm, desert storm as it were, and saying, uh-oh, we're in really bad trouble here, and trying to take refuge from this storm, and taking under this big tree, eucalyptus tree, seems been around thousands of years. It wasn't enough. The storm got through even that. And I said, wow, this is terrible. And then someone placed this granite table, black and white granite tabletop with on stand, metal stand. Like for me, above me, and I was crouched down underneath it, and the rain could not get through that. The storm could not get through that, and it protected me from it. It was black. It was white with black flecks, kind of the granite. You look at it, you say, I see it. The main color is white with some black flecks in it, accents. And so here I am, adopting this color scheme that just seemed to have snowballed. White with black trim. It's a very difficult color scheme to get into, actually. It's kind of like, oh, wow, it's so intense. The ego doesn't like it. But everything I'm getting is sort of that way. Yeah. Very great. And we're here in this culture that has just gone into this bottomless pit of materialism and collapse. And yet here we are talking about the exit strategy from such a collapse. I'm going out today in the grocery store. My God, the energy there is, it's the women that are carrying the energy. They're very much in charge. The men are just drones. Really, they are. It's astonishing. Absolutely, the women are just like charging around, very aggressive, very assertive, very heavy and dark and strong and bossy and overconfident. Really, this tremendous overconfident that we're really smart now. We are so smart. We're way smarter than you. Of course, smartness is the ultimate booby prize, is it not? Smartness is insanity. What they're saying is we have more intense insanity than you do. And then labeling intent in this in the intensity, meaning is they have more. And more is better. This is a sort of circular logic that more is better. We have more intensity than you do. Therefore, we're better. But the intensity is the intensity of insanity. The ego leaves that part out, doesn't it? Well, I can only handle two steps of the logic. That third part, I'm not sure about here. Well, we are sure about it. Wow. Horrible energy. Horrible attitude. Horrors of Babylon. We're warned about this, and it's here. The intensity, more intensity, more activity, more this, more that. I got cut off yesterday, and some of the Mercedes had what are they doing? Just swooped in on me and jammed their way in. I just said, wow, that's a super aggressive, arrogant move to make in a car. And then the Holy Spirit said, well, who's driving? And I said, it's got to be a guy. I mean, Holy Spirit said, you sure? And I checked out through the windows, and it's a woman. It's like, whoa. You never get that kind of driving from a woman before. This was like, get out of my way, Buster. I'm in charge. I'm supposed to be ahead of you. So you better hit the brakes. It's like, wow, okay. But this happens all the time now. It's just extraordinary. So keep this in mind, that more isn't always better. It depends more of what. So it's really not so difficult to follow the Holy Spirit. You just add the little extra effort. Really, the only difference what's made the difference for me is that little extra effort. I just make the extra effort. A little extra effort. Here I am. What time is it? About 9 o'clock at night. I have to get up early. Got a long trip tomorrow. But I'm saying, look, got to make this effort here. Extra, little extra effort. And so this, with logic, you need to look, just make a little extra effort to say, wait a minute, not so fast, let me look at this. It seems like there's something a little out of whack here with the equation that's being trying to be jammed down our throats here. And so you make a little extra effort and say, hey, wait, oh, more, more, Of what? Intensity, but intensity of what? Smartness. Well, smartness is insanity. It's spirit pretending to not be a natural genius. And meaning that spirit is not what it is, which is insanity. But wow, the difference. It's been going this way for about the last 60 years. But it used to be that, well, it's never been good at all, but it used to be there was a very different attitude. But that's gone with the wind. And you feel like little, like as a man, you feel little, useless, just a little serf, like a dog on a leash. Someone told me today their wife has a dog, but the dog doesn't like to go out. She doesn't want to leave the dog alone in the home, so she just stays home with the dog all day. And that's her life, staying with the dog. Who's running this world? Are dogs running this world? What's going on here? I think they are. Certainly, there's a very, very strong animalistic attitude. That's the intensity. It's an animal intensity. It's a feral animal intensity. There isn't the graciousness. And when you find it, it's quite... Well, I'm standing in the store today. I'm getting ready to leave. And this elderly lady comes in the store, and she's kind of looking around all the place, and I kind of notice her and say, huh, I wonder what she's looking for, what's going on. She doesn't really enter the store through the turnstiles, and she looks at me and says, do you work here? And I say, no, but can I help you? Is there anything I can help you with? And she goes, I'm looking for my brother. He has dementia. And so we start talking, and it turns out her brother... just left the house, wanders off from the house, and just goes out into shopping centers and just disappears. And she doesn't know where he is, so she has to search through all these stores to try to find him. And we had this very, very nice talk, and she was wonderful. She was 72 years old. How old the CEO? She said 72, but she was probably in her mid-70s. But I mean, we had no trouble whatsoever communicating and laughing, and it was easy energy. I mean, no, just comfortable. And she just looked at me the way she treated me was just the way you expect to be treated. You know, just normally as far as. Intelligent person, is talking together. Wow, what a massive difference I had in the grocery store with younger crowd, younger women. Holy cow. Night and day. And we enjoyed each other's humor. We're laughing, you know, just in the flow of conversation. You get a feeling of culture there with being able to relate like that. Mutual respect there. Not anymore at all. So, we're looking for the true genius exit strategy, and it seems to be telling the Holy Spirit to just back all the symptoms off of insanity. Back all the symptoms off. We're willing to accept sanity, but we're not willing to have all the symptoms of insanity instantly vanish. Okay, this is the continuity fear. So, we're telling the Holy Spirit, back all the symptoms off. holding this thought, this request, this acceptance in mind, this is just a knockout. There's a knockout for the ego, knockout drops for the ego. But it could certainly cause us trepidation, because the ego says, well, if I'm not here, what's going to keep you from leaping into, you know, reality, knowing? Well, continuity fear will keep us from doing that. And the ego says, well, if I'm not here, you won't have anything. We say, no, we have the Holy Spirit. The ego doesn't know the Holy Spirit, so it thinks that we'll be alone, all alone. No, we have the light. We have the light, which is everything. So it's the opposite of being alone. Believing in the ego is believing in being all alone, because the ego isn't real. It's pretend. So I'm gearing up. I'm putting my money where my faith is, which I've always done. Put it, my money where my faith is. Or the meager amount of money I have, it's tremendous faith, because I've spent every penny that I've had now on gearing up, saying the Holy Spirit's going to do something, so I'm going to get ready. And amazingly, I was talking to someone today, and they said, where do you go for this and this and that? I said, well, I go here. And he goes, well, I go over here. And he kept emphasizing, it's right next to the Home Depot. He says, right next to, it's real cheap there, really good, great place, you know. He kept talking about it. I said, what? That's really odd. The Holy Spirit's trying to get my attention. So I'm driving on a freeway, and suddenly I think something pops in my head. Why don't I go to this store? And I say, I gotta get off the freeway, it's gonna waste time, blah, blah, blah. And then suddenly I realized, oh my gosh, it's next to Home Depot. I said, wow, I gotta go there. So I did go there, and it was fabulous. I found exactly what I wanted. Quite a number of things that I really, really, really wanted at a great price. Holy cow. So you see how grace is talking to us. The grace of God is speaking to us. If we just pay attention, if there's something that someone keeps harping on and emphasizing, and so maybe especially someone you don't really know or a stranger or something, it says, pay attention. Now, wife, that lady said her brother had long gray hair. Long gray hair. Also, she said that he'd smoked during his life a great deal, but now in dementia, she insisted that he insists that he never smoked at all. I said, wow, dementia serves some purpose, doesn't it? It's denial. She also said he thinks he got concussed a lot in football in college. I'm just, what was she getting at? Well, this person who's wandering off and doesn't know where they're going. Gray attempt to mix black and white, which is what the ego wants to do, mix truth and lies. Or really what it wants to do is find a lie that is true. And so it's like we're in dementia. We forgot reality. And we're wandering around aimlessly. Something like that. Or maybe she's going to say long gray hair. We're going to spend a long time with the grays and their wretched technology. That's where we're headed. The world's headed. So, I mean, she just goes to all these stars trying to find him. It happens a lot now. And I said, well, he probably got to put a GPS locator in his shoe or his vest or something, so you can, you know, find out where he is. Or she said, give him these gift cards, and whenever he makes a purchase, it will show up on her iPhone or something. She says she's given him two iPhones, but he's lost both of them. But as I say, I wonder. In the back of my mind, I'm saying maybe he's not as crazy as people think, or not as bad as people think. Is he wandering off the reservation? Is that a bad thing, to wander off the reservation? To freely move about and forget the past? maybe the woman was it was controlling him too much or something. Possible. I don't know. This is it'll come to light in some way. Or maybe it's a great excuse if you're enlightened, if you're in bliss and you're wandering around and people looking at you, can I help you? Can I help you? Oh yeah, I'm looking for my sister. She has dementia that she wandered out of the house and I don't know where she went. So that's why I'm kind of wandering around, kind of looking for my lost sister or brother that have dementia. There's a little white lie there. Of course, everybody here has wandered away and has dementia, spiritual dementia. And I told her, I said, people might look at you and you're wandering all over the place looking around and not going to stores looking like this. They may think you have dementia. That was a parting laugh, which is true, right? Yeah. I said, make sure to have him do some balancing exercise. Or, here's better, have the Holy Spirit back off. I said a prayer for him. I said, have the Holy Spirit back off all the symptoms of insanity. Have the Holy Spirit back off all symptoms of insanity. How about that? It's a very empowering prayer. I feel very empowered by saying that. Have the Holy Spirit back off all symptoms of insanity. Without exception, without any exception. Say that, making no exception whatsoever. Holy Spirit, back off all symptoms of insanity in my experiencing. Wow. You see, you want to get to that point. It's like there's a ledge and you want to jump up on it. You're not sure. Can I make it? Can I make it? Can I make it? That's, that kind of feeling, like inside you kind of get little butterflies, like, wow, I don't know if I can make it or not. That's a very good feeling to get in terms of prayer. Because we realize we've just pushed the envelope and say, oh boy, I'm in for it now, right? I said no exceptions whatsoever. And so this is producing the wow feeling that I say. It's part elation, part trepidation. There's sort of alarm bells are kind of ringing, like, oh my gosh, he really jumped into it now. Wow, here we are. Jumped into the arena, so to speak. Initially, the heart is pounding. It's like, wow. So when you say back off all symptoms of insanity, without any exception, very exciting way to look at it. Very exciting request. Full of wowness. Very much full of wowness. Maybe that gray hair, the grays are causing us to forget just how terrible smartness has treated us. We're having selective forgetful memory about all the shadow of smartness, which is all the catastrophes and how awful it is. And they're trying to make it seem that it's all wonderful. Hey, what was that? Oh, and then someone else later in the day told me about this very interesting story. Somebody lost a permit. They put down the wrong number of parking spaces. They asked for too much. And they should have just asked to put down four. Put down four. And not six. I said, wow, interesting. The ego's putting down the sixth dimension, which is, you might call that above the fifth, which is, you might say, knowingness. is put it's trying to scare us and put spiritual true spirituality down and direct our attention to the sixth and say you should go to the, no you should go for the sixth go for the sixth dimension instead of the fifth instead of the death free realm go for throwing all perception away instantly, which was too much continuity fear. So it's pressuring us for the sixth instead of we need to just put down the four, meaning we're saying we don't like the fourth dimension. Just say we don't like the fourth dimension, but don't try to go to the sixth. Go to the fifth. What did I do today? I bought a 5 hybrid golf club, a used one. Very nice club. And I realized, wow, I can really use this club a lot. I started thinking, and this whole, I said, you know what? That's an ideal club, because I've been kind of in between clubs, and so in the back of my mind, I said, I need this 5 hybrid. So I got the 5th, I got the 5. Put away the 4. Now, don't try to use the 4 for everything. But the 4th dimension, which is the dimension of smartness, which is pursuing smartness to try to pursue it to the ultimate extent. This is what we want to put down. We say no. No to the fourth dimension of this smartness. And you see this fourth dimension come in with the computer people and the artificial intelligence and robotic people. This is fourth dimension. So we put that down and say, no, we're not going to kick that. But we're not going to try and grab the sixth. That's too high. It's reaching too high for us. Especially in our culture right now. Might be a different story if you're at some, you know, monastery in Tibet that's going 1,000 years and you're secluded from the world and you're just, you know, maybe you can go to the sixth. That's possible. But in the situation we're in now with our culture, in the world, the way the world is now, the fifth is fabulous. The fifth is fabulous. I was thinking, where can I hit that 5? Oh my gosh, the 2nd hole, the 4th hole, the 5th hole, the 8th hole, the 9th hole, the 11th hole, the 12th hole, the 14th hole. The possible 17th and definitely the 18th. Definitely the 18th. So on all those holes, it's an ideal club. And I didn't have it. I do now. Fascinating what's going on, actually. So the fifth dimension, we don't want to try to reach higher than that. We're aware there's something higher than that, which is fine. It's not like the fifth prepares us for the sixth. So certainly we're aware. But we're not trying to leap into the sixth. The ego is trying to inspire us to leap. Now, I certainly bring up the sixth, but it's in the context of the fifth, looking at it from a pragmatic standpoint. So if we aim too high, we may feel too intimidated. But if we say, no, we can just ease off all the symptoms of insanity. Ease off of these symptoms of insanity. Let the potentiality still remain for them, but just ease off all the symptoms. It's like, say, well, I don't get a cold anymore, but I could if I really tried, but I'm not going to really try. Like that. I could have the symptoms of insanity, but I'm not going to really try to, so I'm not going to have them. Because I'm choosing sanity. So just, Holy Spirit, without making a single exception, ease off all the symptoms of insanity. And ease off all the symptoms of insanity. It's like hitting gold. and just keep saying this, and just full stop in the wow. Don't get into a struggle with the ego, or say, well, I wonder what the ego's objections to this would be. Don't even be curious about it. Remember, curiosity killed the cat. This is one of our points of emphasis, is don't be curious. Don't turn back and say, well, what the ego's thinking about this? Just say, I don't care. You know, whatever it's thinking of, it's thinking about, I ask the Holy Spirit to ease off all symptoms of insanity without any exception. So what does it really matter what the ego's thinking? Wow, bird just, nine past 9 o'clock, and I suddenly started causing a commotion in the hedge there. Wow. Maybe it fell off its perch. I don't know. It sounded like it. Maybe this is the wow shocked it here. The Shakti got shocked. The Shakti got shocked. That is for sure. And again, no curiosity. This is key, very key. Do not have curiosity about how the ego is reacting or what it might do, etc. Because we ask the Holy Spirit to ease off all symptoms. So that includes anything the ego might try to do. And so if we're curious about what is the ego going to do, it doesn't matter because we asked all symptoms. So it's a moot point at this point. So don't be curious about it. We get these smart people who want this world to be utopia for smartness, who will gang up and try to ban people from moving about those ideas they don't like, or maybe might be geniuses they don't want them moving around or saying anything. But what is this ganging up? Gangsters. They're gangsters. This is gangster culture we live in right now. And this is not just talking about the underworld or the various, you know, gangster elements in society and stuff like that. It's more than that. It's this ganging up. Social media is a gangster media. These are the gangsters. We live in a gangster world right now, actually. They'll gang up and say, we don't like these ideas, this person. Let's put them in irons, put restrictions on them. That's gangster society. And of course, then it's the nice people who are doing this, right? Supposedly. They're gangsters. Let's start letting this cat out of the bag. These folks are gangsters, plain and simple. And they love to point to the Christians and other religious people throughout history. Say, oh, look how terrible you're awful, you're terrible. You know, 600, 700,000 years ago, look how awful you were. Well, they're trying to displace our attention because, well, you know, we're focused on who are the gangsters now, right? That's what's important. And it's these folks are. These smart folks are the gangsters right now. They're the gangsters. I've called them the Nazis. A lot of people call them Nazis. It's term fits, but I just call it gangster culture. They feel like they have the right to tell everybody what to do because they feel this vision of utopia, just like the Nazis did. Nazis had a vision of utopia, a smart utopia for smart people, for the Uber, you know, what do they call them? The chosen race, the Aryan superior race, the smart ones, the ones who are like smartest. That they should rule the world and conform it to this religion of smartness and physical culture and smartness and all that. And so now we have the same thing, except it's on steroids. Yeah, we know what kind of dark shadow the Nazis brought. Well, what kind of dark shadow is going to come from this global culture now, of this global arrogance? Big dark cloud, for sure. So, but we can ease off all symptoms of insanity simultaneously, concurrently, simultaneously. It doesn't have to be a linear process. This is what's very important. The ego consists, well, what's the linear process? Meaning, where's the smartness? No linear process. It's all simultaneous. Well, what's affecting? There must be some process. Something must come first. No, it's not a chemical reaction. It's a Holy Spirit action. Now with white, there's nothing going on, is there? It's all happening at once. What do they say, that white has all the colors in it? And then as far as materiality goes, black has all the, like pigment has all the colors. Black paint has all the colors in it, something like that. Mix all the colors together, you get black paint. Whereas in light, the white light has all colors in it. You put it through a prism, right? So it's all here simultaneously. Maybe that's what the white is symbolizing, and black symbolizes perception, and red might symbolize the flesh. So we still have a body. So spirit is and perception, body, spirit, belief, and body. We still keep that framework somewhat, right? But in hindsight, we look back and all the stuff that we thought was, wasn't really that great in the past. Well, by comparison, now it seems fantastic. So, oh my God, long for the good old days. It's so much better than anything now. Whereas back then we thought, well, we can do a lot better than this. It's not that great. So, you don't realize what you have until you lose it. We thought the music was going to get better. Oh my gosh, it plateaued and then fell off a cliff. And wow. We thought everything was going to get better, but it plateaued and fell off a cliff. So what is our way to get free of this? Is it Holy Spirit, without making a single exception, back off all my symptoms of insanity. All symptoms of insanity, back off. Back them off without any exception. All simultaneously. Lighten me up, lighten me up, lighten me up. Without any exception, lighten me up. Oh, here's something fabulously interesting. My driver cover for my golf club driver is I have a white cover, and I put this decal on, a Giants decal, 2014 World Series champion, and finally I took it off. I said, that's enough of that, but it left all the stickum on it, and the stickum got dirty, and so I've had this cover looking real dirty for a long time. Just terribly dirty. I thought, nothing I can do about it. I thought maybe it's just what happened. I didn't really pay much attention. And tonight I said, Lisa, let me see if that's dirt or is that something that's abrasion that's worn the white away. I thought that might be it. I didn't really look closely at it. I looked at it. I said, son of a gun, that looks like it's stickum. So I took Goo Gone and I worked and worked and worked at it and I removed every spot from it. Now it's just gleaming, spotless white. I said, wow, what a great metaphor for what we can do now. We think, we're not sure if the light has been compromised or it's just pretense. Well, it's pretense. So just have some faith and take a look at it. And say, well, let me give it a try here. And we'll find out that nothing's happened to the light. Just like the head cover, nothing happened to it. It's in fabulous condition. Just with some stickum was on it. Then the stickum got dirty and looked like abrasions. The light was superficial. The white was superficial. It had been abraded. No, not the case. I don't know what the Holy Spirit's doing. It's really putting on a big push. I've got stuff coming. What do I've got? Three, four things. Four things still to come. Next week, wow. I'm just like a makeover. It's like a sort of like a pragmatic spiritual makeover is taking place. So just let this register. Just hear it and say, you know what? Wow, maybe I can let that happen in my life too. Let the Holy Spirit ease up all symptoms. Ease up all symptoms of insanity without any exception. Now I went, what did I do? I went and bought some chocolate milk. That's supposed to be the best thing to drink after exercise, chocolate milk. That's all the rage now, because it's got everything you need. I'll throw in some chocolate protein drink mix and some powder, chocolate powder, and banana or something. I'll just make it some like super recovery drink. It's a good excuse to drink chocolate milk. I work out, I get to drink chocolate milk. I haven't drinking chocolate milk in ages. You think that, oh, that's for kids. I'm supposed to drink chocolate milk. So wait, I love chocolate milk. Why can't I drink chocolate milk? Well, it's got sugar in it. Yeah, but if you're working out and eating right, you know what? You can have a little sugar. It's just if you eat too much processed foods, it's bad. But the way I'm eating is, I get 0% fat Valle yogurt. Throw in some blueberries. I mean, this is not natural sugar of the syrup kind of things. Natural sugar there. Maybe a Swiss cheese sandwich, I mean, whole wheat bread. Not having too much sugar, so chocolate milk can do that, right? So your good habits is not like you have to just be insane about them. At times it's good to be really strict, but a little bit of sugar is not going to be a problem, so. I'm looking forward to the chocolate milk. Yes, sir. I'm eating macaroni salad, but it's a real good one. It's got olives, it's got egg white, and probably egg yolk mixed in the sort of the sauce that's in, and onions and celery and macaroni, plus the pasta, those carbohydrates. That's pretty good. Not, you know, that's it. Don't eat too much. It's just it's a matter of don't eat so much. One of the keys is don't eat too much. And once you thin down, your stomach shrinks, then you don't eat so much. You eat some, but that's it. Then you say, oh, I'm still kind of full. So you stop. And this is how you maintain weight. Don't gorge. Don't gorge. This is the problem. Don't eat out of nervousness. Don't gorge. I had a long talk today with a guy just about my age who's having troubles, and I tried to inspire him. I said, you got to make a decision. Your body's freezing up on you. He says, yeah. I mean, everything you told me. I said, look, four months ago, I was in the same boat as you 4 months ago. And he said, well, yeah, but I just don't have the time. It's so hard to make the time. I said, I understand. That is true. Somehow I made the time, and jump rope is very helpful for that. I just, every time I go out the door, I just do some stretching and some jump rope and some little weights, and then go about my way. It's 5 minutes here, 5 minutes there, 5 minutes here, 5 minutes there, like that. He's saying, well, I joined a gym, but I've only gone twice, 4 months or 2 months or whatever. That's not going to get it done because, well, I got to get all the kids together, the family, and it's too hard to do. See, this won't work. This will not work. Get a jump rope. Just start jumping rope. I grew up, everybody jumped rope. Everybody had a jump rope. People are jumping rope all over the place. That and hula hooping. Jumping rope works. Well, the smart will say, well, that's not smart. I need to do something smart. But it's genius, isn't it? Because it works, and it's something that we're able to fit into our busy lives and schedules, which the ego is saying, well, you know, how do we, sure we want to, or let's join a big club and do this and this, and you never have time to do it. Never have time to do it. That's what the ego loves, is failure. So be the genius. Get a jump rope. Get a jump rope and be a genius. And everyone I ask, do you jump rope? Jump rope? Oh, no, I don't jump rope. No. There's like some kind of prohibition against it in the mind of smartness. They're looking for something smarter. They got to go into these really sophisticated gyms with all this really sophisticated electronic equipment that tells them every last little parameter. And they got to be on this really sophisticated program with the trainer, and then da 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 da. Oh, but you know, I'm so busy, I can't quite make time. I'll go once a week, and then oh, but I got to, you know, miss this week, and before you know it, the year's finished, right? Whereas me, I'll jump rope 3, 4, 5 times a day. Knock out 100, knock out 150. I haven't tried that straight 150, but every single day I'm knocking it out. So who's you know, where's the genius? One's smart and the other's genius. There's a major differentiation here. And the Holy Spirit warned me, says, don't get too caught up in sports nutrition. The technical stuff, and so I backed off of that. Just you know, after you're done, drink chocolate milk. After you've really worked out and you feel your muscles, the body's really trying to hit the muscles, get something, just give it chocolate milk with some, throw some protein powder in into that. See, that's not sophisticated. It's not smart, is it? It just works. Quick, easy, a nice reward for working hard, right? Chocolate milk. I think I feel like going to jump on rope right now. Get some. Okay, yeah. So this is genius. Reward yourself. Find a reward that gets you motivated. The Holy Spirit did with me for a trip. It put into my mind that I'm going to have this vacation where I want to go, and I started, and lo and behold, got the vacation. So it's pushing me now, saying something else is coming really great. Get ready for it. I said, okay. Go to bed hungry. Go to bed hungry. Very important. Go to bed. Try to go to bed hungry. Not too hungry. But try to go to bed hungry. I mean, this culture just stuffing itself with things, with everything, including food. Everybody's garage, you can't move. So full of stuff. Well, this is just seems like common sense, but applying it to the now, applying it to spiritual practice, to the importance, is genius. Applying it in the flow of this culture where we're aiming now, asking the Holy Spirit to back off all symptoms of insanity, which will end up lead us to the fifth dimension, actually, or the death-free realm. It will lead us, we will find ourselves there at some point here. Most likely. Because everything else is just acute symptoms of insanity, actually. Fourth dimension is very acute symptoms of insanity. You might call it an insane asylum, as the third dimension certainly is. The fourth dimension is just even worse than insane asylum, because they're very arrogant about it. That's for sure. someone, I was asked today, you never guess who called me. And I said, I said, well, how about this person? They said, they're dead. And I just thought, well, I mean, he said, you never guess who called me. I mean, that would be something that nobody would guess, right? But in my mind, well, they can call you. Why can't they call you? They might not be able to call you on the phone. You know, we're keeping spirit hanging on the telephone. You know, spirit's calling us. We're just not picking up the phone. I'm in the phone booth. That's the one across the hall. If you don't answer, I'll just ring it off the wall. I know you're there, but I just had to call. Don't keep me hanging on the telephone. So spirit is calling us on the telephone, on a phone, communicating with us. We're just not picking up the phone. So the spirit communicates and is communicating with us, and often through other people that we just have chance meeting. So that lady, we were talking about chipping and chipping her brother, and I told her, you know, pretty soon they'll put a chip under everyone. She goes, yeah, they already do that with animals. Interesting how we're being led down to be animalistic. And animals will accept chipping, will they not? And you know where anyone is at any time. And she, like she said, I can track someone if I give them a smart these cards. Wherever they use it, I know where they used it, right on my app on my iPhone. So you can keep track of where people are going, ultimately what they're buying, right? I imagine the chip that's in debit cards now is probably, certainly it gives a location and time of when you're buying and what you're buying. It may also have code, you know, barcode saying, you know, what is being bought here? What are you buying? How do we know it's not keeping track of that? Certainly, we know that everything we're doing is being tracked as much as possible now. Maybe they'll start with dementia people. Anyone who has dementia like that, they'll chip them. And it usually starts with that. The so-called insane in this world, they experiment and do stuff on them first, and then start broadening the definition. That'll be children. Oh, we got to protect the children. That'll be this people, and then it'll be a sign of fidelity. The men will have to be chipped. The women will say, "What's the matter? You don't want to be chipped? Is that?" It seems to me that you've got something, you know, guilty to hide, something to hide. If you didn't have anything to hide, why wouldn't you want to be chipped? And the men will say, "Oh yeah, I got to do it for the make sure my wife thinks that, you know, knows that I'm very faithful to her, or my significant other." And so it'll become like some sort of thing just remember the hyphenated names that came out in the 70s and 80s, and everyone got married, the women had to have a hyphenated name. And you know, to not do that, you know, to say no, you can't do that. It's like, why are you trying? What are you trying to do? Well, it may become a fad like that, where all couples think this is a sign of advanced smartness in relationship. This is we have a smart relationship. We're both chipped, so we know where we are, and so there's no, you know, concerns. We have a smart relationship. If I get lost, something happens, you'll be able to find me. See, this is where it's going. I really feel the younger generation will take to being chipped very, very avidly. And it'll be a sign of being smart. The smart generation. We have a smart relationship. Yeah. You have an insane relationship, is what it really is, means. You have a relationship with insanity. What kind of relationship is that? There's no relationship at all, which is why you get this feeling of futility, which is why you project it off on catastrophe and blame the catastrophe for the feeling of futility. This is what they do. You don't see many people who are over the top anymore in terms of a true counterculture, true genius culture. You just don't see it. It's like it's disappeared with the dodo bird. Yeah, back in the 60s, we had Wavy Gravy and Crazy George and these various counterculture icons that, were like over the top. And, like court jesters. We had all these court jesters, actually. The rock stars were court jesters. They really were, a lot of them. And, we enjoyed that. Because they could get away with it. The court jester could get away with it, right? In the court of corporate, military, industrial complex, culture. In the court. In the court of corporate military industrial culture, we had these court jesters. Yeah, these rock stars are dressing in the most outrageous ways and saying the most outrageous stuff and doing the outrageous stuff and trashing hotel rooms. I mean, we loved it. And they got away with it because they were making money for the corporations, selling records to the kids, selling stuff, cooking the kids into all sorts of stuff. But where are the court jesters now? Boy, we could use some, couldn't we? I'm not so good at, I'm good at going along with that. I don't feel I'm so good at being directly the court jester. But certainly I could go with that flow. We got the Super Bowl coming to the Bay Area pretty soon, don't we? Playoffs have already started. My gosh, it's coming up in about a month's time. Holy smokes. Maybe the Holy Spirit can get me out of town for that Super Bowl. Get me out of town. I don't like the vibe. Or should I cover it with my camera? Why, what's the point of that? You go to be a court jester there, nobody gets it. A court jester, you gotta have people that get it. Be somewhere other than the Bay Area during the Super Bowl week. The Super Bowl. Spend all my money. That's okay. I put my money where my faith is. See what the Holy Spirit will do and back off all symptoms of insanity here. Back off all symptoms of insanity. It includes everything. Nothing excluded from that. Now, is that a void? No. The Holy Spirit is a complete continuum, full plenum continuum. So how could be a void? That is very interesting. Getting out of the Bay Area tomorrow. That's pretty cool. See, we give time here to the weightiness of all this. It is intense weightiness. We're in the most intense year on record, actually. The most intense time ever. These screw ups, fourth dimensional screw ups, are really going to try and put one over on everyone. This is maybe the worst ever. Maybe one of the biggest put-ons ever. It's happening right now in this world. So I keep looking. Where's the court jester? I need to find them. And let's get the jesting going, let's get the right prayer going, and let's get all symptoms of insanity backed off. At least in our case, we can't trifle with these fourth dimensional folks. They're not to be trifled with. They take themselves much too seriously, and their insanity takes itself much too seriously. They're very devoted to insanity. This is not to be trifled with, because of our continuity issue. The jester can trifle with it, but we must not trifle with the jester. I mean, this is serious business on our part. It's very serious business indeed. And the problem is nobody takes it seriously, but no one around me takes it seriously at all. Not even faintly serious in any way. It's like, wow, this is crazy. So let's all call upon the court jesters to make their appearance. And they may seem to be, the world may think they're crazy, but the sort of benign craziness, like, oh, well, that's kind of a shame, but what can we do? But they may not be crazy at all. We'll be able to discern the difference. There may be somebody going around looking for... Have you seen, hi, have you seen someone? Well, I'm looking for someone who's lost with dementia. And of course, but then they seem like actually they're the ones who have dementia, but they really don't. They really don't. It's just a way. They're actually looking for us, you see. They're jesting us. We're the ones with dementia. We're the ones who've forgotten reality. So we have a desperate need for this. And how can we face up all these issues? Desperation. If I'm asked, well, how can you be the way I am? Desperation. Desperation is a very good motivator. Necessity is the mother of invention, right? Well, desperation certainly provides the impetus for really focusing in on it. And just need to be getting more desperate. This is a... Who can jest this world? This is the question right now. Who is it that can jest this world? Well, we need to find out. Who can be the jester for this very... The world's so serious. They're dead serious about deadness. They're insanely serious about insanity. And so this is getting... You know, we're jittery. It's like, hey, this isn't too much. This is so over the top. That's enough. Getting really worrisome now. We thought maybe they'll back off at some point. No. So here we go. Oh, somebody told me about Montana today. I was talking to a clerk. You know, just nice to people. Someone says, hi, how are you? And I said, hey, I'm doing great. How are you doing today? You know, sincerely. And they say, oh, I'm okay. And I kind of strike up a conversation. It's not easy to talk with clerks, but you know, some of them, they still have a pulse. And somehow we got around to how cold it was. I said, there's not much winter here. He said, well, it's not like Billings, Montana. And I said, oh, I got a friend who's got family up in Billings. He said, oh, really? Started talking about Montana. He said, well, you know, the western part, he says, it's really nice. It's like a cross between this and this and this, and it's like gorgeous. He says, it's just one of the most beautiful places in the world, western Montana. He said, most people don't realize this. He said, you can go down to Idaho. It's fabulous there too, northern Idaho. He says, it's eastern Montana that's kind of, you know, more flat and more boring and prairie-ish kind of thing, but western is just says, off the charts. And I said, wow, maybe I have to go there, check it out. And I've had a number of people tell me that Western Montana is very beautiful. The lakes and the rivers and the mountains and the valley, I mean, it's just very scenic and beautiful. I don't think I'm going there right now. It's minus something. Hey. Interesting. A lot of people are going up to the Pacific Northwest and up going up that way, Washington, Oregon, Idaho, Montana, fleeing the madness. Okay, so Holy Spirit, without making one single exception whatsoever, back all symptoms of insanity off, back them all off. Ease all symptoms of insanity. Ease off all symptoms of insanity. And just hold that and see how it feels. Experience how it feels. It might feel like a Biden's at some point. Yeah, right? It's possible, huh? Just an idea. Maybe that man that wandered off had went to the fifth dimension, the ladies in the fourth or third. I can't find him. I can't find him. I don't know where he went. I don't know where he went. He keeps wandering off again, going into abstraction. Forgot the past, saying the past doesn't matter. Those are just symptoms of insanity. I don't have to catalog. Why do I need to catalog symptoms of insanity? I can back off all symptoms simultaneously, so I don't need to catalog them. I don't need to quantify them or measure them at all. All that's just useless. Waste of time, is it not? I can back off all symptoms of insanity concurrently, simultaneously. So we're not talking about process or measurement or any of that chemistry, physics. We're not talking about physics or chemistry here. I'm not talking about science here. I'm not talking about nature. This is super nature. This is miraculous. This is the miracle of the Holy Spirit. I wore sufficient clothing tonight, so I'm not cold. That's great. Long sleeve turtleneck, wool sweater, heavy micro fleece with wind-resistant jacket, and then a shell over that. It's feeling okay. The rest of me, though, is not. My shoes are freezing. It's not that cold. We're okay. pleasantly chilly. Love this. The request of the Holy Spirit is like a doorway. It certainly is. I'm sort of noticing the doorway more and more. Wow. Helps us escape time, space, process, form, and science and nature, does it not? Provides the escape from it. New updates are available, the computer shows. It's constant. I mean, this is one of the traps, is it not? All the more you get into technology, the more updates there are. Your life becomes governed by it, absorbed by it, like a black hole. I found that out after really delving into it and really experiencing it. I said, wow, you can waste your life, entire life like this easily. That's enough. Enough is enough here. Let's back off of it. Kind of cool. YouTube, they do whatever updates they do, they just do them and that's it. You don't have to do anything to update anything. I don't update anything. I don't do any updates on computers that I can think of. I haven't updated anything in a long time at all. Nothing. No updates. I guess occasionally, like once a year, maybe I'll do some Windows updates. But by and large, you can see no updates. My phone, no updates. I'm never bothered by, can you update this, update this. No apps on my phone, so I'm not updating any of the apps. Nothing. I never have to do any updating on my phone. That's why I call it a genius phone. And no updates here on YouTube. So I don't do any updates. How about that? We are entering an update-free realm. Death through realm is an update-free realm. Keep that in mind. Nothing to update. Everything's always up to date because it never dies. It never suffers. It's changeless, and it implies the perfection of reality. And it's always up to date in this way. We don't have to do a thing to update it. We need to do nothing. No updates are required. I got a brush and I cleaned the soles of my shoes today, golf shoes. I cleaned the soles really good. They're spick and span. I said, wow, this is interesting. I'm kind of on a little bit of a clean trip too, cleaning stuff off. Get the rust off, get the dirt off, why not? No updates, tech updates, how about that? And no desire for them at all. I don't need to update the future. I don't need to do any updates. Not really. Except for if there's pragmatic, anything that implies plausible inference that reality is still real, you could say that's a good update. But changing the color scheme is you might say, this is not so much an update. It's not really a tech update, is it? It's just a genius move to involving pragmatic, plausible inference. Back off all symptoms of insanity. Wow. Very nice dream. Compasses, all-encompassing, is it not? That's the door. That's the open door. That request is itself the open door. just like now itself is the now. Abidance itself is abidance. This request itself is the open door. The request for this door is itself the door. And we're like, wow, I didn't know there was a door. Everybody said there's no door. I had this dream. I was walking and up behind stage and people said, what are you doing? You're going to get in big trouble. There's no way out. We have to kowtow to this attempt to make truth and lies equal, make lies equal to truth. And the black and the white, so to speak. And as far as color scheme, and I was walking backstage, and they say, "You're crazy. What are you doing? You're toast." And I said, "No, I think there's a way out." And then I saw this door. And I said, "Wow, wide open door. Exit, wide open door." Everybody in that auditorium was sure there's no way out. They're transfixed in their seats because they don't want to incur the wrath of these bureaucratic potentates. Potentatic alliance. And yet now I'm seeing there is a door. So this is a huge wow. There is a door. Huge relief. But no time to collapse in relief. It's let's go through the door now. Let's keep taking care of business. TCB, as Elvis used to say. And where? TCB, taking care of business. When Elvis died, the world has never been the same. It's true. It really is true. I mean, when the king died, he said that the king can't die. It's not possible. Elvis was bigger than life. Truly. Bigger than life. I mean, he's just Elvis. He's the guy that just gives away Cadillacs. I mean, he's just, you know, he can do whatever he wants to. He's a court jester. I mean, he can do whatever he wants to do. Nobody can tell Elvis what to do. And then when Elvis died, it's like, wow, what? Never been the same. There's never been a character like that quite since then, really. Just not saying Elvis was good or bad, but he just was this larger than life figure that the establishment had to kowtow to because they get votes, you know, and support if they say, oh yeah, Elvis likes me, I like Elvis. But to this day, so many people say, "Nah, Elvis didn't die. He's alive somewhere." The rumor still gained steam and traction. Really, in my generation, you know, the baby boomers, we think, "Yeah, Elvis, he got away. He said that I don't want to deal with all this stuff anymore. So he's went incognito and he's witness protection program. Elvis is still alive somewhere." People want to believe that. That's good for tabloids. Dogs. People walking dogs late at night. Everybody's got to walk their dog these days. We used to do that with yo-yos, walking the dog. It's a lot easier than walking a real dog. People say the stickers everywhere. Dog is my co-pilot. Oh, here, Holy Spirit is my co-pilot. Maybe we're at, well, we are at apocalyptic times. Maybe we'll start seeing the dead. I keep thinking these people can communicate from the dead. We'll be able to communicate with them. My cats that have passed on, I keep seeing, I'm going to see them again. I think I said last time I had this, I was sitting here taping, I suddenly felt like this cat that I had, this extraordinary cat, is suddenly going to come back and see me. And I'll see him just come walking up to me. And then I discovered a video on my computer, digging through all the files. There was this video with this cat. I took video of this cat. I said, "Oh my God, there he is. Maybe he's coming back. This cat is capable of that." People thought, everybody met this cat, said, "This is not a cat. This is some spiritual being. This is extraordinary. This cat is really something else." This cat had presence, a real powerful presence, positive presence, very friendly presence, but it didn't think itself inferior to us at all. No, it's very, very amazing. So maybe, maybe those who want to see Elvis, maybe they'll see him soon. OC, CC writer. OC, what you have done. Maybe we'll CC Elvis. I used to be able to sing like Elvis. It's pretty easy, actually. It's pretty easy. That's why there's so many imitators. Elvis impersonators. It's not that difficult to sing like Elvis. Didn't he wear the white jumpsuit with the high collar? The collar up, like white collar. The sequins. I got a shirt with these beads on it today. They're inside the shirt though. They're like, I don't know what they're for. They're supposed to cool you down or something. It's very interesting. These metal beads on the back. On the inside of the shirt, you can't see them from the outside, but they touch your skin. It's like, what is this for? But some kind of cool. It's supposed to be for hot weather. Inner sequence. Maybe we'll be inner Elvis. Inner sequence. Little takeoff on Elvis. Not the external ones, but the inner ones. Inner sequence and whatever like he had, all that stuff. So we do what we always do, let the resonance continue. So we chit chat about this and that, about Elvis and whatever else, right? But inside, the reverberation of this prayer, we're making to the Holy Spirit, a prayer of saying, "Holy Spirit, I accept this. This is the most powerful prayer I've ever come across." A lifetime of searching for prayer that's effective. I'm searching for the door out, the exit from this place. This is it. This is the prayer. So, of course, it's very profound. This is the door. So we just sit here for a while, as they say, mellow out off the high, mellow out off the high. This is a natural high. The drug users, they sit around and they kind of hang out together and go through the high, and then they mellow out from the high, and then they go eat something, and you know, there's this thing, they go on a trip together, shared experience kind of thing. Well, here it's a natural high. It's like supreme relief. Oh my gosh, we found the exit, the way out, the way to the fifth dimension, the way to the death-free realm, the way to abidance. We found it. It's simultaneously everywhere. We are searching for something specifically to back off of, some symptom. What's the key symptom? But now we realize, back off all of them simultaneously. All of them simultaneously. How are we doing here? Really good, huh? Great. Very great. So this time we spend mellowing out off this high is very important. It's a shared trip, a natural high trip. This is a type of trips festival right here, actually, but it's a natural high trips festival. Maybe that's something we can do, start the natural high trips festival. And we'll just say this prayer. We'll insist upon it. I gotta go to hospital tomorrow. I'll say the prayer there for everybody in the hospital. Okay. So the wow continues to reverberate here very strongly, as this is our goal. This is very great. Again, we reach our goal. Now just make it the new normal. Make it the new normal. It's a profound reverberation with this prayer. It's just a new normal for us. We get used to it. It's like a new body type, like a more athletic type. We feel, okay, this is what I am now. No, we're a much more spiritual type now. This is my type now. I'm a very spiritual type. Right now, this is, so we just get used to it. This is the new normal. All right, very great. We're gonna end this one now, and just take time, much time as you need, just to, and keep saying this prayer. Keep saying the prayer when you can. Remember, attend spiritual gym. Don't be curious about the ego. What its take on it is doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Very great. That's it for this one.